example, what the Quran says. And if the Quran is clear.
Yeah.
So, coming from you, Abbas, you know, we know ourselves, we're quite familiar with each other now.
Yes, yes.
You know, you come to church, which I appreciate, you know. Yes, you enjoy the service.
Yes,
and God willing, you one day come to Christ.
Yeah,
God's grace, who knows, who knows?
How do you know I'm not already
Christian?
With Christ, yeah.
I've seen your wife with a full veil and everything.
No, I follow, I follow Christ as a Muslim.
We'll get to
that's
that.
What I mean, yeah.
But one of the things I've always asked Muslims is that the Quran speaks about the revelation coming to Muhammad as a clear verse. So it's clear. So the Quran is clear. Would you agree with that? I really feel. Let me just try and find the surah if I can remember.
It's important when we read the scripture, we read exactly what the words are. Because
I totally agree.
So
Surah
1689.
Oh, what am I doing? I've got something on here.
I'll go
with the wrong. No, I'm good. But let me just turn off my speaker. Can you hear it?
Yeah, I can. Can you put the volume down, maybe?
Yeah. Okay, so Surah 1689.
Yeah.
Okay, you read it out. You read it out.
O Muhammad, in brackets, warn them of the coming of a day when we shall bring forth a witness against them from each community, and we shall bring you forth as a witness against them all. It is for that purpose we sent down the book to you, which makes everything clear and serves as a guidance and mercy and glad tidings to those who have submitted to Allah.
Okay, so there we see that Allah is saying to Muhammad that we bring to you a clear book, obviously speaking about the Quran. Let me just quickly read you Surah 6114. It says, shall I seek a judge other than Allah, while it is He who has sent down unto you the book, the Quran, explained in detail. Surah 41:3, it says, a book whereof the verses are explained in detail. A Quran.
Sorry, what was that?
41? Surah 41,
Ayah 3.
Yeah, a book whereof the verses are explained in detail. A Quran in Arabic for the people who know. So, for me, I mean, again, it's verses upon verses that stipulate that Allah has instructed or has given to Muhammad a clear revelation from Himself so that the people can understand. And so would you agree that the Quran is a clear book and you can understand? Is it possible for a human being to understand the whole of the Quran?
Okay. When Allah says Quran is a clear book, okay. When we need to understand the Quran, we have to see intertextual study. Intertextually, what the Quran is talking about. Because there's a verse in the Quran, chapter 3, verse 7, I believe it says that there are verses which are easy to understand and there are verses which are ambiguous. Anyone who has an illness in his heart will go for the meaning which are ambiguous. So if we understand the Quran as a whole, we know it's not every single verse everyone can understand. Of course it's not. It's not. I mean, you want me to show you that verse?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Chapter 3, verse 7.
Okay, so Surah
Ali Imran, verse 7.
Yeah, because that's an interesting verse.
Yes.
I would like you to read it out because it's interesting what it says. Yeah. Because it actually explains something which is very pertinent to our discussion.
It is He who has revealed the
book. Hold on, am I in the right place? Surah 30.
Chapter 3, verse 7.
Oh, sorry, I went to 33. Okay, 30. So it's
chapter
verse 3. Chapter 3,
verse 7.
Verse 7, I got you.
You want to read it?
Okay, let me read it. Okay, it says here, it is He who has sent down to you, Muhammad, a book, which is the Quran. In it are verses that are entirely clear. Okay, they are the foundations of the book. I'm trying to get away from these brackets. Verses, and those are the verses of Al-Akam, which is the commandments.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay?
Clear, yes, commandments.
Right? Obligatory duties and al-hudud, which are the laws for the punishment of thieves and adulterers. And others not entirely clear.
Right.
Okay? Yeah. So as for those in whose hearts there is deviation from the truth, they follow that which is not entirely clear.
Yes.
Thereof seeking al-fitna, which is polytheism and trials.
Yeah.
And seeking for its hidden meaning. So from my understanding, it says that there are some parts that are clear in this verse, okay? And there are some parts
which are ambiguous,
that are not so clear.
That's right.
Now, for me, First of all, I would say, okay, you can obviously respond to this. I would say, first of all, there is a bit of a slight contradiction, because in one verse, it's saying that there's verses that are clear, or the parts of the Quran that's clear. However, there is other parts, but though some are clear, but others are not clear. So it's a clear conflict with each other. That's number one. But number two, it also states...
No,
yeah, I'm just... You can answer fully. Yeah. Okay. But it also says this. It says that the unclear verses are in whose hearts there is deviation.
That's right.
The truth, they follow that which is not entirely clear. So the people who don't understand the Quran, correct me if I'm wrong, it's because they've been deviated, or they've gone away from seeking the truth. Is that the correct understanding of that?
No, it's not saying that.
Okay, so what
those
is it saying?
Those who have a deviation in their heart, they go for these ambiguous verses to
correct.
Find the meaning they like to find it.
Right.
It's not necessarily they're seeking for the truth, because they have deviation in their heart, so they don't go for the clear verses. If they are clear verses, their commands are clear, they are ignoring them, but they're going on the ambiguous verses.
Right.
And then they're going for the meaning, what they like to see the meaning. You know,
right. Okay.
In their benefit.
So basically, they find a meaning. So
yes.
My question to you is this:
they interpret in their own way, which suits
right.
them.
Right. Yeah. So my question then is this: would we say, you know, both believers in a God, even though we understand God in different ways, would we say that God is a good communicator? In other words, if He gives us a word, He would want us to understand it. He wouldn't give us information if He knows that you're going to be completely baffled or confused about this particular word. So do you feel that God will communicate a word to you or give you the Quran?
Question, there are a lot of implications are behind
well,
it.
I'm asking,
so what I understand what you're trying to say. What I say as a Muslim, the Quran is the book of guidance. So Allah guide every single human being. Even you are completely layman, you couldn't understand, couldn't read, couldn't write. For you, there's enough guidance for you to go to paradise. There's only one God. Believe in the prophets, believe in the angels, believe in the commands of the books. Do your fasting, do your salah. These are the things, and be a good human being. Any human being can understand that. You don't have to be knowledgeable, you're a scholar person, to understand these basic things. So Quran came here as a guidance. When Allah say, Allah makes these things clear, meaning for you to go to paradise, the path is clear, the guidance is clear. But yes, there are verses which only a scholars can understand, a learned people can understand. So Allah says in the Quran somewhere else, if you don't understand something, ask to the people of knowledge. Do you know the verse? Are you familiar with the verse?
I can't think of it. Yeah.
If you don't know, go
ask the Jews. Ask the Jews
and Christians. No.
This, well, go on. Continue your answer.
Ask the people of knowledge.
Okay.
Meaning as a Muslim.
But there's another verse
that
says, go on to the people of the book.
Yeah,
right?
I can answer you that.
Okay.
I can answer
but let's stick to
so this
for
one.
Yeah.
There are, if anything you don't understand, go to the people of knowledge. And people of knowledge are expert in these things. They spend their lifetime to understand what the Quranic meanings are. So as a layman, there's a guidance, enough guidance for you, clear guidance for you to go to paradise. You have to be a good Muslim. But something you don't understand, there are scholars there to help you. So when you say the verses are clear, it's not for every single human being. It's clear mean clear as a guidance.
Okay. So would you, when it says clear as a guidance just to get to paradise, that's what he was basically saying essentially.
Yeah.
It's been in the Quran that says that these verses are only, I mean the Quran is only given to you specifically to the Quran, not for any other things that you may need to know, but only clear, specific to get to paradise and not to understand it in its entirety.
This is the book of guidance.
Yeah.
And the Quran did say this is the book of guidance.
I understand
so
that. But
what do you understand with guidance?
What you said is that you brought out certain basics, foundational things of the Islamic faith, which is to, you know, to pray and to fast and things like that, which you're saying is fundamental, and that's what the Quran expects you to understand. Now, I'm asking you, in response to that, is the Quran now stating that it's not really there to be clear about other passages apart from the fundamentals and the foundational things of Islam? Is that what you're stating? I just want to understand.
That's what the verse says that.
Right.
You just read chapter 3 verse, that exactly verse says that.
Okay.
There are verses which are clear and they are the foundation of the book. What is the foundation of the book here?
Right.
Quran is the guidance from Allah.
But no, it speaks about the truth. It doesn't actually
Let's
say...
Let's read that again. Chapter 3 verse
okay.
7. Let's read
okay.
that We need to understand what Allah is... Let me read it, yeah? Because you're reading some things in the brackets which confuse things.
Yeah, so is it...
Chapter 3 verse 7.
Yes.
It is He who has revealed the book to you. Some of His verses are absolutely clear and lucid, and these are the core of the book. Others are ambiguous.
These are the core of the book.
Yeah. So core of the book. Quran is a book of guidance. Right. That's in the Quran, it says that. Right. If you, I can have a look, but I can't, top of my head, I don't remember where the verse is. Quran is a book of guidance from Allah. So the core of the book is the guidance.
Right. So,
and that is to take you close to Allah.
So am I correct in them saying?
As a righteous human being, yes.
So am I correct in them saying that it's only the core, or as you say, the foundational things that are clear.
That's right.
And other things in the Quran are not so clear, but you should go to the scholars if you want clarity. Why? Because Allah is a good communicator and He communicates clearly enough for people who perhaps, you know, have studied. I was speaking to one of the Muslim brothers and he was saying some scholars have studied for 25, 30 years, and there will be people who can understand the Quran, which you can, as a layman, can get some knowledge from. Is that, am I summarizing
this? This is not compulsory. As a good Muslim, as a Muslim who can live a righteous life to go to paradise, you don't have to go in the detail of the Quran. As I told you, basic things of Islam are the pillars of Islam and the Imaniyat, believing in the Prophet.
My question is a bit more specific. Yeah. A bit more specific. You're saying, is the Quran a book that we can understand in its entirety?
If you go research, you can.
Okay, but can I ask you a question?
Hang on a minute. Yeah. I know you're going to go to the Haruf and Mukatta.
No, yeah. I'm going to ask you the Surah 19.
Right.
Yes, yeah, so Surah 19. Can you tell me any scholar, anyone who knows the meaning of these words in the Quran?
Now,
any Muslim, any scholar?
When you ask me a question, you didn't even let me finish my answer.
You're saying every single thing
of the Quran, everyone can understand that. That's what you're saying.
I'm asking.
I didn't make that claim.
I'm asking, okay, is Allah going to give you information? Because remember earlier, I said to you this. If somebody is trying to communicate to me, especially God, which, you know, I'm sure you'd say Allah is a great communicator, okay? Now, would He communicate words which He knows you're not going to understand? That's my question. You said, oh well, no, there's parts that...
He's also wise.
Okay.
Some things are only with Him. We might know it one day about this Haruf and Muqattat you're talking about, yeah? But I can answer you that.
Well, there's different ones, but I'm getting sure 19.
But what is it
saying? Okay, let's read this. Okay,
Hamim, is it?
It says this. You read it and tell me who can... Can you give me a scholar you say that you need to go
writing
to?
Writing very small.
Surah 19, verse 1 and verse 1.
Verse 1.
What's the understanding of that? Or which scholar can I go to get understanding of this Quran?
Let me see what it says. Kaf, Ha, Ya, and Sad. Yeah?
What does that mean?
These are the letters. And scholars have their own understanding and their explanations to that as well. But they are not certain 100% that that's what it means. But there could be, these words could be part of Allah's wisdom. Why I say that? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to preach in the marketplaces. He used to play in the Makkah. Marketplaces, nobody hears him. He used to stand like that in the marketplace preaching, like speaker's corner. And some scholars say that this is probably part of the wisdom. If you stand up there and you start preaching about the God, people are saying many things, nobody hears it. But when he stand up and he says, for example, in English, if somebody stands there, they say A, B, C, D, E. It's five word letters there. Everybody might look back what this guy is talking about. And they might lend their ear to what this person is talking about. So some scholars say these Haruf Muqattat, which came in 19th chapter, they are probably part of the wisdom of Allah. So people can lend their ear to hear what he's trying to say. They probably have no real meaning apart from people lend their ears.
Can I respond to that? Don't put up words. Again, you know, you have the same thing in Surah 42. You have it in other verses.
Chapter 2, yes.
So you have words which were given to Allah, from Allah to Muhammad.
Yeah.
Allah is supposed to be this great communicator who wants to give information to people. Now, but you're saying that scholars even don't understand what these words are. So it's just like this. It's just like me, for example. I go to a job interview, and then a person who's interviewing me ask me a question, I respond, and I tell them, all right, some letters or some foreign language. And then they say, wait, hold on, what did you say? Right? And I say, well, you know, it's a miracle. I'm all wise, I understand. You should just take me and just give me the job. Would that person take me serious? Or would they say, well, hold on, no, we're not going to give you the job. Now, think about it, it's even greater. Think about Allah, who is the greatest so-called communicator. He gives words to mankind, and they can't understand it. It's not just once, it's not just twice, it's not three times, and these are just letters. I mean, we can go to other verses, but the point I'm making is that if Allah is a great communicator, and he wants us to know his word, why is it that he cannot give his word simply enough for us to understand it?
What I want to know...
Is he not?
Allah, whatever we need to understand, he does. He can understand. Now you say your own God is mysterious. It has a mystery in Trinity.
You
Christians also say the same thing as well.
I'll
bring it back to you. Can you explain the Trinity? Many Christians say, oh, it's a mystery. Nobody can really explain.
I'll explain that in a minute.
So there are things in Christianity as well.
I will explain the Trinity. We don't have a problem explaining the Trinity.
They keep Christianity on
each. Well, one minute, sir. It's just between, we're just discussing.
You have lots of words.
So, I think the foundation of our discussion is this. Okay, and I am going to talk about the Trinity. But the core of our discussion is this. You believe that the words of the Quran were kind of like dictated to Muhammad, and so they're verbatim. The words come straight from the words of Allah. He's communicated to some people who he knows cannot understand what he says. One, why would he do that? Number two, if you communicate to somebody and they only end up confused, how can we say that he's a great communicator, and how can we trust that he actually says what he actually means, what he says, which is that I've given you these words, Muhammad, to give the truth, or to give my words to mankind? We can't take that verse seriously, because he says this, for example, and another thing, he says he's clear in one place, when he says some verses are unclear. And so it seems like this muddled, this jumbled up kind of confusion. Until now, you haven't been able to show me where anyone, any scholar, any Muslim, any sheikh or imam can show us what these words are in the Quran.
Muhammad Sassan did say that in the hadith, that these are the meanings of these Huruf al-Muqattat is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah, these are meanings of that. But so when you made a point that these letters confuse people. That's why you use confuse people.
You don't know what it means.
No Muslim is confused about that. No Muslim. We are very clear about it. This meaning of this is with Allah. Allah might tell us on the day of judgment what that means. But it doesn't confuse no Muslim. It doesn't affect my Islam, my religion, even a jot. And Muhammad has not clarified it. That these meanings are only Allah knows these meanings. These are the meanings with Allah. So this is in the Quran. This is a mystery with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as you said, we are not confused about it.
But you see, what you're missing the point is this. Is why bother? It's just like me. It's just like me and you, as a Muslim and a Christian.
Godwin, Allah knows. We don't know everything.
That's fine. Let me respond to you.
We are limited.
It's just like you as a Muslim and me as a Christian start talking about something we both don't care about or understand. Maybe we start talking about Buddhism. Okay? Somebody would ask us, why are you even having a conversation in the first place? Why would Allah give you information that you don't need in the first place? Why would he give you information that you don't understand when he says this word is for mankind? When he says in his word that it's clear, that the Quran is clear, although you show me a verse that some are not clear, why would he do this? That's the question we're asking.
Allah knows the answer.
You don't know the answer.
I'm not going to pretend that I know
fine.
Why. Because Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did say that.
So you don't know the answer.
Only Allah knows the reason for that. And we know for sure there is a reason why they are there.
Okay. So do you know what I would conclude? I would conclude that, number one, I would conclude that Allah is not clear. That's what I would say. I would say that although the Quran does say that Allah is clear, and I'm sure most Muslims would say God is clear and he communicates effectively, I would say no, that's not true. That's my conclusion. because you've just agreed that no one understands what Allah is trying to say. It was some of the verses that I've quoted to you. I would also conclude that why should I trust what he has to say, or why would I believe that other words that he's trying, so-called trying to communicate through the Quran is true if some of the basic fundamentals he's not even allowing me to understand? And then I would also conclude that can I trust Islam? Because everything is based on Allah, who calls himself the Al-Haq, which is the truth, okay? And that he gives you the truth. He will not say something is true if it's not true. He will not say something is clear if it's not clear. And so it draws me to my conclusions that is Islam really trustworthy?
But can you use the same criteria with your Bible?
Let's do that.
Because in your Bible, in the Old Testament, really
you're talking about the Trinity. Can we go do that first?
No, I'm talking.
So now you're changing.
I can talk Trinity as well. But okay. Before that,
just answer that.
You can't dictate me what I have to say. Okay. This is my. Now in your own Bible, in the Old Testament, first of all, nowhere it mentions that Jesus, the Messiah, is going to die for the sins of the world. Or if it does, the Jews completely misunderstood it. It's not clear to the Jews. If you make interpretation of the verse, the Jews interpret it a different way. So there's a confliction here. There's a conflict here. Secondly, why Jesus is nowhere mentioned in the Old Testament by name? If his name was going to be Jesus, why he's not mentioned by name? 20,000 verses are in the Old Testament. I mean, one verse it takes only just to say he's going to be Jesus and he's going to die for the sins of the world with name. Why is it left ambiguous? What I'm saying is, you implies you take something out from the Old Testament, which Jews don't understand that. Just to me, it's clear that it's not very clear. The Old Testament is not very clear as well.
So, okay, can I respond to that?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's start off with the book of Isaiah. Okay? Let's see, because that's the Old Testament.
Yeah.
Right. Isaiah chapter... let's say 53. I'm just trying to find it. Let me start from verse. Let's start from number one. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of parched ground. He has no stately form or majesty, but he should look upon him. That we should look upon him, no appearance, but we should be attracted to him. He was despised and forsaken of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and like one from whom men hide their face. He was despised and we did not esteem him. Surely our griefs he himself bore, and his sorrows he carried, yet we ourselves esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, for our sins. He was crushed for our iniquities, for our sins. The chastising for our well-being fell upon him, and by the scourging we are healed. All of us like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned his own way, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall upon him. So I'll stop reading there, but
what it means.
Okay, but the text over and over again is speaking about sin. It's speaking explicitly about sin. The question I'd ask my Muslim friends is, anywhere in the Bible does it speak about being what does it say? Crushed.
What are you
I'm responding to
getting from it.
I'm getting from these verses that we as human beings, Israel, have strayed away. Okay, we've gone to our own ways. This person has, the Bible says, been crushed for our iniquities. He was pierced for our transgressions. Okay, now the question I'd ask is, who else in the entirety of the whole Bible, the whole of the New Testament, was pierced for sin? If you go into the New Testament, you find over and over again where only one person, only Jesus Christ was pierced for sins, okay? Sins of humanity.
Hold on, one second. It says of our. Our who?
Okay. Can I just respond to that? Okay. So, there's only one person who was pierced, according to the the New Testament, crushed for our sins. It says, we like sheep have gone astray. And it's speaking about sinful mankind. In addition to that, and I'm going to address what you're saying. In addition to that, when you go to the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 18, and then we speak about who is this prophet that's supposed to be sent to... to the people, okay? And then only in, you go into the book of John, I can find it, John 2, I believe. And when it says, I think it was one of the apostles, he says, surely you are the man that Moses spoke about, the prophet that was supposed to be sent, and it was Jesus Christ. Then you go to Isaiah 42, and it speaks about, it speaks about Yahweh. Okay, as Yahweh being, it speaks about Yahweh being set this servant.
Can we talk about the words we just read?
Okay, you ask a question.
We need to back it up.
You asked a question, and I'm responding to the question.
And it's not very clear.
I'm saying to you that throughout the Old Testament, it is so clear, but there was only one person that was pierced for the sins of Israel. Okay, only one person. And when you go to the New Testament, you see, there was only one person that was pierced for the sins of Israel. Okay? And so the verse is unambiguous. Oh yeah, it's the suffering servants of Israel.
No, the whole you just read it, it doesn't say the sins of Israel.
Okay, who has... Who...
First of all, it doesn't prove that he's God, isn't it? It doesn't prove that he's God. Somebody is going to pay for somebody's sin or dying for our sins. What do you mean?
The question you ask...
If it's so clear, why Jews do not get it, well, how do you get it?
Okay.
They read the same book before you, but they didn't get it. If it's so crystal clear, how come they miss out on it?
The question you asked wasn't, does it prove he's God? The question you asked is
the Bible clear?
Was it clear? And I asked you, and I'll throw the question back to you. Hold on, 1 second.
And I say, where Jesus mentioned by name.
Sir, Abbas, I'll ask you a quick, throw it back to you. And tell me if, as a logical, rational, reasonable person, you can respond to this. Is there anywhere in the New Testament that it speaks about someone other than Jesus that was pierced for transgressions or pierced for sins? Is there any other person? Because as far as I know, only Jesus. Can you show me in the Bible that you say is not clear that somebody else was pierced?
I'm not arguing that.
But that's your argument. Your argument is it's not clear.
I'm not arguing that.
But for any rational person who is looking at these words in the Old Testament, and then we look into history and we see who else was pierced for the sins of Israel.
How does it make him God?
Right.
I'm saying that.
But that's a different question.
No, Jews don't get it.
Now that's a different question.
It's the same question. It's a related question. You say
it's related. Okay, it's related. But it's not the same question.
No, look, if he's died for the sins, you're implying it's God. Jews don't imply, even they read that thing, they don't imply it's going to be God who's going to die or who's going to be died because of somebody's sins. He's going to pay somebody's sins. They're not implying that it's God. So what I'm saying is, it's not clear. Your Bible, the question was, the Quran is not very clear.
Okay.
I throw it back to you. Your Bible is not very clear as well. There are many things that are not very clear in the Bible. For example,
let's stay on that point. Yeah. Well, you just mentioned that Jews do not believe that this verse is clear. Okay? You are still aware, as a Muslim,
that there's a man, Messiah, going to die for the sins.
You don't believe exactly. Now, it's funny that Muslims will always use, perhaps maybe like Bar Ehrman or Jews or people for example, Jews do not believe that Jesus is a Messiah. They don't believe Jesus is a Messiah. And so you're going to use, hold on 1 second, let me just respond.
They don't believe
that Jesus is
going to be a Messiah. Brother, he's going to die
brother,
the
brother let me respond to you. Yeah. You're saying that our standard is going to be by what the Jews say. Our standard is because the Jews... No, hold on. You're saying because the Jews believe that Jesus was not God or Jesus... Yes, you did. You said that the Jews do not believe that...
This Messiah
Brother, let me just respond. And then you can respond to the other person. You are saying that the Jews do not believe that this person speaking in Israel was Jesus.
No, I didn't say that.
clarify your point.
Okay. I said the Jews read the same Isaiah 53, but they do not take
come
it as
the same conclusion.
Yeah, they didn't come to the same conclusion that this person, I didn't use the word Jesus, mentioned it.
That's my point.
This person is going to die for the sins of the world, no matter who is going to be.
Okay.
Even they don't believe the Messiah, they reject Jesus, of course. They don't believe the Messiah is going to come, he's going to die for the sins of the world. They read the same Bible, but they did not conclude that.
That's so my point. That's my point. Listen very carefully, Abbas. My point is this exactly. If you are going to say that our standard for truth universally must come from Jews, then you have to be consistent. You've got to be consistent, because my standard for truth does not come from the Jews. Even if they disagree with me, my standard for truth doesn't come from Buddhists, doesn't come from Islam. And I'm sure yours doesn't come from Christianity. So, if you're going to use that, you must be consistent. The Jews also don't believe that Jesus is the Messiah.
You know what?
The Jews don't also, hold on. The Jews also don't believe Muhammad was a prophet. So going back to our understanding, it's very clear. It's very clear what I'm saying. I asked you a question, I'm throwing it back to you. Is there any other person, because you said this verse is not clear, any other person in the New Testament that was pierced for the sins of man of Israel? Can you give me?
I think the contention has changed. The original contention was, if God is so good communicator, he should have made things clear for everybody to understand. So I prove it to you through your Bible. If God of the Bible is not a very good communicator, why? Because if he's a good communicator, he should make understand Jews same as Christians do. Because they are reading the same scripture, but they are concluding. But let me speak.
You said something.
They are concluding with the same verse they're reading, but their conclusion is different. You are reading same, different. Meaning God is not a very good communicator by according to your standards. He doesn't make it very clear for everybody. And as I said, you didn't answer that. Why God doesn't mention the name Jesus in the Old Testament?
So, Abbas, once again, your premise is wrong. Okay. Again, what you are stating is that God is not a great communicator, according to me, in the Bible, yes. I'm saying God does not communicate. You're saying that my God of the Bible is not a good communicator because the Jews don't understand it. Hold on one second. My assertion or my conclusion, which I give to you, is that why your God is not good communication is because nobody understands it. Not even the Muslims. Neither the Jews, neither the Christians, no one. At least in Christianity, you can bring it out, and according to my understanding, and I drew a parallel with the New Testament, we conclude that Jesus did say that. Now, what you're trying to do is mark a standard that you won't even keep to yourself. You're saying the standard is whatever the Jews say, therefore, it must be, we must take it as truth. But you will stick to that because you know the Jews don't believe Muhammad's a prophet. You know the Jews don't believe that Jesus is a Messiah. You know the Jews don't believe in praying to Mecca. Numerous things that the Jews don't believe. So you cannot use the Jews as a standard. Let me summarize and then you respond. So again, my question to you, which I think is different from your question, is this. Is if the Quran, if Allah is a great communicator, and no one, including the Muslims, including your scholars, including everybody who he says this word, the Quran, is for, and you can't understand it, how can you then ascertain that it's clear? Do you understand the question?
Yes, I do. First of all, I will tackle with the Jewish and the Christian when they're reading the same Bible. The difference here is Jews and Christians are taking the different understanding of the same words. They have different contention, different understanding. They're taking different understanding, which create confusion. So God sent the words and it confuses people reading the same words, they are confused. Different from the Quran. Quran is clear. Allah is clear about Huruf al-Muqattat. It's clear. The meaning of this is with Allah. Who told us? Muhammad Sassan told us. It's very clear. No Muslim is confused about, oh, this means that and this means that. They can guess, but they know Allah, only Allah knows. They can just guess, as I said. But
no Muslim is confused about huruf al-muqatta. So there's a difference there. Your God makes confusion between Jews and Christians. Let me make my point. You want to accept that or not? It's up to you.
No,
Muslim is confused about huruf al-muqatta.
I don't want us to be talking past each other. I want us to have a fruitful dialogue.
You want to hear me out?
No. I'm saying, I want you to understand what I'm saying to you. I'm not asking you. Again, I want to be clear. I'm not asking you. This is my conclusion that it confuses people. But that's not my question to you. My question to you is, Allah, is the Quran clear? And has Allah communicated it clearly? And has He given the word? Hold on one second. No, you haven't, because you keep... Let me finish. You keep going to something else. I'm not asking about confusion. I'm saying, can it be understood by anybody? The Bible, at least we can affirm that we can understand the Bible. Whether the other people disagree with us, whether the Muslims disagree, whether the Jews disagree, but we can at least say, well, hold on, we understand what this is from God, yeah? But we can give you our understanding of it. But you, I've shown you several surahs, several ayahs, and you said that no Muslim understands this. So if Allah gives you a verse, what is the point of Him giving you a verse you can't understand? At least as a Christian, I can understand what God has given
you. So you're saying it's not possible in the book of Allah, there are meanings.
The Quran.
In the Quran.
Yes.
So the meaning, only Allah can understand that, and He might let us know whenever. Maybe there's a wisdom behind it.
Where is the wisdom behind it?
Might not on the day of judgment.
But do you see the problem? Do you see the problem I have?
Because
that's a problem, because
it did not affect the message of God. Not at all. It's just in the beginning, it doesn't affect anything.
Let me repeat it. If the Quran says it's the clear book, it's in detail.
No, you put it words in it. No.
This is a clear book.
Allah says, I told you.
I'll read it again.
You need to understand the Quran as a whole.
Right. But then what
chapter
else?
Chapter 3, verse 7, what does it say?
Let me read.
Stop saying that. Everything has a context.
Okay. Which event? So let me read. So there's several. But let me read another verse.
Let's do one by one.
Surah 41. It says, a book whereof the verses are explained in detail. Yeah, so the verses, it didn't say some verses, it says the verses are explained in detail. A Quran in Arabic for people to know.
41 verse 3, isn't it?
41 verse 3.
So let's go one by one.
So 6, 114.
No, don't go anywhere.
All the verses
say. Read the context first.
So,
this is the revelation for the most merciful, the most compassionate. A book whose verses have been well expounded on Arabic Quran for those who have knowledge. For those who have knowledge. So the verses are.
So who has knowledge? Who has knowledge?
The scholars.
The scholars. So why don't the scholars know the verses?
No.
Let's say every single verse of the book.
Right. And Muhammad explained us these verses. This Habib meaning is not even
Abbas. Why would God give the word? He says to mankind, if they're not going to understand it, why not just scrap those verses and give you something you do understand? What's the point? You recite the Quran, right?
They were never supposed to be understood.
That's my point. This makes no sense. You say that children can recite the Quran. You recite it over and over again, every day. And so you recite these words, but they don't even understand what it means. If this word is a communication to Allah, mankind, that Muhammad is his last prophet, then shouldn't this and God, omniscient, all-knowing, knows that he wants to communicate to him? Why would he give them something they don't understand? And what you're saying is you're conflating two things. You're saying just because some people understand a certain text in the Bible, like the Torah or the Book of the Prophets and things like that, differently from the Christians, therefore God has sent confusion, whereas I'm not even debating that. I'm simply asking you that at least someone from the Jews can interpret what they or have an understanding of their Tanakh. And we as a Christians, we can at least give you an understanding of the Bible. But your response to me is that we have verses that nobody knows, but Allah just threw it to us just for the sake of it.
No, and people ask me the question. I'm responding again and again, same thing.
It's a miracle. No, it's the wisdom of God.
Nobody's supposed to understand these things. And it's only this.
Why? Why give you verse? Okay,
I don't know if I don't know the answer.
So I'm communicating to someone with no meaning. Where is the wisdom? That's not like foolishness.
The wisdom I told you.
If I told you
the wisdom. I actually explained to you the wisdom.
Explain the wisdom.
Okay. What when scholars say that?
Don't put a speech.
What scholars say that?
Bro, you're right.
That's my nice. So scholars did say that. Yeah. Scholars did say that he probably is, there's wisdom behind it. And I explained to you, when Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to preach, there's only one God, he's preaching to you, I'm the messenger of God. Nobody's paying attention. He's in the marketplace, in the Makkah, marketplace. Then Allah sent these things for people to attend, be attentive. For example, if somebody stand over there and start preaching, we don't pay attention. But if somebody starts saying 1, 2, 3, 4, everybody will look back and say, what is he talking about? So some scholars say this is probably a wisdom of Allah. So when Muhammad is a priest, people will give attention to him. So it's not for definite, for sure. So there could be a wisdom behind it and be
important. So it's interesting you said that. I said there could be a wisdom behind it. They said, but you don't know that.
No, we don't.
Right, okay.
So scholars did say
scholars are saying that. Muhammad didn't say that.
Nobody hold on. For it.
So Muhammad didn't say that. Allah didn't say that. But somehow you conclude that, scholars have concluded that there must be wisdom, even though we know that anybody trying to communicate to someone something that they can't understand is foolishness. We know that, as logical, rational, reasoning people, we know that if I try to communicate to him in my native tongue and he doesn't speak the same language, it will sound like gibberish to him. And it will be useless and it will not help him to be a better, it will not help him in any way. So, what I'll say, can you be honest, one question? I have to go.
Do you know this in the Bible as well? There's the words of letters like that in the book of Psalms.
Salam?
No, the letter. Just letter, like Aleph or something like that. I'm trying to find it. And Psalms, I can assure you, in the book of Psalms, it also starts with this kind of letter.
So, you're saying we won't understand
letters? Yeah, it's only a letter.
I think we do understand. I think you're going to go to the word. It's not Salah.
Well, I'm just trying to look like Psalms is massive.
I'm trying to predict about Salah.
But I can.
Which is a break in the.
No, not Salah.
Okay.
I can show you there's a letter I saw it myself. Yeah, have you ever come across?
Show to me.
The Psalms.
I know Muslim asked me the other day.
But there's 120, 150 chapters, books of Psalms. It's going to take me a while, but I can show you.
I'll tell you what you do, Abbas, because I have to go
back. No problem.
We'll talk again. But I just want to say, truth is, we've had many debates, many discussions, and what we're trying to do is enlighten you to the good news, the glorious gospel, which is Jesus Christ. Now the problem is, when you start with Muhammad, when you start with the Quran, you're always going to deviate. But if you start with Jesus Christ, start with what he said, and you think about what the gospel message is, which is for all mankind. Jesus Christ wouldn't give you a gospel message that's for some people, whether it's the Jews or the Arabs, he'll give it for all mankind, and he'll give it in such a way in which even anybody can understand, regardless of where you're from. That's why, for example, the Greek and the Hebrew, we can translate it. Whereas, sometimes you'd always say to me, well, do you know what? We can't understand these verses. We can't understand. You have to be an Arabic scholar or things like that.
I didn't say that.
No, you. I'm talking about Muslim in general. I'm talking about in general. I'm not talking about these verses. But in general, Muslims always say to me, you don't speak Arabic, you cannot understand the Quran.
Did I ever say that to you?
Muslims.
Did I say that?
Yeah, I said Muslims. So they'll say to me, no, this is an interpretation of the Quran. This is the meaning of the Quran. So you're familiar with it. That's what they say is the meaning. You can't understand the Quran. Whereas what we're saying is that you can understand what God says. You can understand. Let me just finish. You can understand that Jesus Christ, who loves you so much, he wants to communicate to you something. He would not just waste his words, just give you stuff that you have to. But your mind's boggling, you don't understand what's going on. He will give you everything you need so that you can be able to come out. This false religion, good Islam.
I know you're saying that.
And so that's what I want to say. Let's continue this later because I have to go.
My question to you is, when you read the Bible, don't you see there are a lot of conflictions in the statements? There are fabrications in it.
And you haven't shown me one.
Oh, you want me to show you?
No, I'm saying I have to go now, but I'm saying. Next time, what you do, you look for a word in Psalms, look it up,
okay,
bring it to
no
me,
problem, no problem.
And we'll discuss it again. Yeah? Figure out once
and
again,
we can talk about
it's a pleasure
the
talking
contradictions
to you.
Between the Quran and
anyway, anything you want to talk about, we've got nothing to hide in our Bible.
That is very important.
We've got nothing to hide in our Bible.
If you're relying your eternity on some book, it has to be perfect. It shouldn't have any errors.
We've got nothing to hide in our Bible.
Let's talk about this.
Okay, I've got to go.
No problem.
But I say we'll continue this,
and
like we did last week.
Yes, Psalms as well.
Yes, bring all the evidence.
And if I find a letter in Psalms, what do you say about
that? Baba, we have no issues with our Bible. And we'll talk more in detail. We don't have the time.
No problem.
All right, God bless.
God bless.
Okay. So, again, speaking to my Muslim brother Abbas, we found verses in the Quran which he himself, you know, honest about him. He says we don't have an understanding. He says that no scholars around the world understand what this Quran says. And so there's a lot of you okay? And so what he's saying is that Allah gives you a verse just randomly. He says these words from Quran are for mankind, however, you can't understand what it means. Which to me, there's a conflict in terms of communication, the communicator and to the listener. And what I'll say is, turn away from the Quran, turn to Jesus, turn to the Bible. It contains the words of Jesus, it contains the truth. And Jesus Christ, He came, He died for the sins of all of mankind, that we could receive salvation. This is our message to the Muslims. God bless you.